morning, everyone out there in on their computers or TVs. We're so glad we can still be with you in this capacity, and we're just going to sing and preach the word today, and we hope that you all are feeling well and doing all right. This first one's called Happy Day, and this is just talking about that greatest day in history when when death was beaten and our Savior saved us. Happy Day.
Everybody, it's good to see you today, and Pastor Chase, welcome. It's good to see you today too.
It's
and
good to see you too.
We're here again. We've had quite an interesting morning. We believe everything is going to go pretty well. If we do have a few glitches, it looks like maybe that everybody is doing live streaming now, and so our sound people have worked really, really hard this morning. And so whatever happens, just enjoy the service, and we will all be able to move on and serve the Lord this morning and have everything go well in our hearts. As we all know, there's a lot of anxiety going on out there, and if you're like me, I have my days where I have some anxiety. I've seen people be honest, and I appreciate that. on Facebook or just in person. These are sometimes very difficult times and difficult days. But one of the things that I see from the people of God is just this constant and sometimes intense dependence upon God. And so today, Pastor Chase and I are going to do a little reader's theater for you, an opportunity, a little dialogue here for us to get our service started and remember the faithfulness and the goodness of God.
Okay, God, here's the thing. I'm scared. And I'm trying not to be, but I am.
I know you are. So you want to talk about it?
Do we need to? I mean, don't you know everything already?
Well, let's talk about it anyway. We've done this before.
I know. I just feel like I should be bigger, or I feel like I should be stronger, or something else by now. Okay, all right. So I'm afraid that I'll do everything that I can to protect my family, but it won't be enough. I'm afraid that someone that I love is going to die. I'm afraid that the world just won't go back to the way that it will be. I'm afraid my life is just going to always be this unsettling.
Anything else?
Everything else.
Chase, remember how your son woke up the other night and came running down the hall to your bedroom?
Yeah.
You were still awake, so when you heard him running, you started calling out to him before he even got to you. Remember? You remember?
Yeah,
what you called out to him?
I said, "You're okay, you're okay, you're okay. I'm here."
Why did you call out to him? Why didn't you just wait for him to get to the room?
Because I wanted him to know that I was awake and that I heard him and that he didn't have to be afraid until he reached the end of the dark hallway.
Exactly. You know, I hear you, my child. I hear your thoughts racing like feet down the dark hallway. There's another side to all of this, you know, and that's that I'm already there. I've seen the end of it all, and I want you to know right here as you walk through it all, you're okay. I haven't gone to sleep, and I'll never be asleep.
Ken, can we just sit here together for a while? Can we just sit here for a minute before I have to go back and face it all?
There's nothing I'd love more. Heavenly Father, as we enter into the rest of our service, as we laugh a little bit, as we continue to worship in music, and as we listen to your word today, we just want you to know that we are your children, and there are times we do get anxious. But Lord, hear our hearts today. Our faith is in you. We love you. We know you are there. We know you're not asleep at the wheel. And so calm us continually. And then during those times when we recognize how great and powerful you are, would you just continue to make us a witness in our world, with our families, with our community, with everything that goes on. We just thank you. Thank you for your power. And thank you for your love. And thank you, Lord, that you do not grow weary. You are never tired. And you are never asleep. I just pray again a blessing upon all of the people who are listening in today, whether they be a part of our congregation or from somewhere else. I just ask a blessing upon all of us. We would again just remember all of our healthcare workers, our first responders, our business community, just our school system. Lord, there are so many people who are out there on the front lines doing everything they can to get us through this time. Would you be with them, and would you minister to them and protect them and empower them in every way? And we would ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Well, Pastor Chase, we've got some interesting news this morning, and that looks like maybe Easter's not gonna happen the way that we would normally do it here in the church.
Nope, the governor has issued a stay-at-home policy, which it doesn't really change much, all except for the fact that if you're not going out for medicine or for food, or if you're not making an emergency trip, that that you would stay at home to decline the curve.
All right. Mm-hmm. So everything will still be live stream on that Sunday. We'll still have church and all of that. But I was just interested this morning. You mentioned something to me. I thought I'd just throw it out there. Maybe we get some feedback from people.
Maybe. Since Easter isn't on the same day every year, since the church determines what day Easter's going to be on, maybe, just maybe, we have Easter after all of this is done through. I mean, what better way to celebrate coming out of this pandemic and coming out of all this situation than celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ?
So we'll see what happens. But yeah, Easter is just kind of on the church calendar.
Right.
Easter should be every day of the year.
Really?
And so we're going to do some thinking about having Easter the first Sunday that we can all get back. So stay tuned. And so if you still do want to bring some eggs in, you can still do that, and we'll still plan on having a great resurrection service whenever we have the opportunity to get back together. So we do have some announcements this morning.
We do. Yep. Some of these announcements were filmed before the governor's policy was issued, so they may be handled differently.
have a few captions.
Yep, that's for sure.
And we did want everybody to know that we tried to have a little humor injected, maybe very little. We're not sure. We'll find out.
Yep.
But one of the things that we do want to tell you before the video is we're just trying to have some fun, and sometimes laughing at some of the things that are going on, it is a little bit of good medicine. Mm-hmm. But we do want you to be safe, and we do want you to do what our healthcare professionals are doing. As you noticed, I'm kind of leaning a little further away.
But that's because I have bad breath.
That's true. As the announcements go on. But we do want you to be safe. And some of the fun that we're going to be having in the video in no way is to poke fun at social distancing, mm-hmm. and all of the things that we're trying to do. We want to encourage you to do what everybody is doing, and that is to do what our leaders are telling us to do. But we thought for our announcements this morning, there's not a whole lot. We'd just have a little fun with it. So here you go.
Disclaimer. We understand and respect the need for social distancing. The intent for this video is to bring appropriate laughter to the situation. Also, these announcements were recorded prior to the governor's issued stay-at-home policy, so some announcements will be handled differently.
Pastor Todd!
Social distancing! Six feet!
Pastor Todd, we need the morning announcements for this morning.
All right. Well, hello, everyone. We are glad to be reporting to you from this day from the local church news for IndyNaz. I'm Pastor Todd.
And I am sorry.
We are currently practicing social distancing among the staff as Pastor Bill took the last bottle of Germ-X and Chase asked too many questions. Well, on top of all of this, we're still planning for the Easter season. If all goes well, we're continuing to plan for a Good Friday service on April 10th at 6:30, remembering the death of our Savior on the cross. And then April 12th is Easter Sunday, for which we hope to have a combined service at 10:30 a.m. with breakfast at 9:30. Chase will have all the details for you about the events after Easter Sunday. But right now, we will turn it over to our office thief, Bill, talking about tithes and offerings. Bill?
Is he still mad about the Germ-X? And did you know you can't even get a haircut right now?
Hi, Chase.
Hi, I'm Pastor Bill. We're continuing to collect tithes and offerings during this time. To do so, we as a church have provided several different ways for you to give as we move through these challenging times. For those of you that are online, you can go to www.indynazarene.org and click on the button that says Giving at the top of the page. There, you can either click the button to start giving, or you can scan the QR code with your phone and follow the prompts. You can also now simply text your offering to any amount to 84321. Once that happens, you'll get a response, and then you'll just click on the link in the text. It takes about 2 minutes overall, and it gives you an excuse to be on your phone while the kids are in the background screaming. If you prefer the traditional ways, we have a drop box provided in the overhang drive-thru, and you can put those in at any time. You also prefer to deliver them in person to the office. We're open Monday through Friday, 9 to noon. We also will accept giving through the mail. To help me explain how the mail works, here's Pastor Chase.
Hello!
Now, Chase is a millennial, so he probably has no idea how postage works.
Wait, I thought we were mailing something.
We are. Chase will first take his offering and put it in an envelope.
What kind of app is this?
After Chase puts his gift in the envelope, he will then lick the tab on the back to seal it shut.
Say what? You want me to lick this? It's paper! But we're in some sort of pandemic! I don't even know how to spell pandemic! Fine.
After writing the address from where he is sending from and to where he is sending it to, Chase will add a stamp on the top right-hand corner and drop it off at the post office to be mailed to us.
Oh, why did the door not open?
And if you need any help at all during this time, don't feel bad about giving the office a call. We'll be happy to help you, or you can call any one of the pastors. Now back to you, Todd.
Well, as we continue to plan for Easter, Pastor Chase is still collecting candy-filled eggs for the Easter egg hunt. Those donations can be brought by the office anytime, Monday through Friday, from 9 to 12. If we are unable to have the Easter egg hunt past post-Sunday service, we can arrange for the eggs to be dropped off at your house. To be put on a list for eggs to be delivered to you, just call the office, contact Pastor Chase, and we'll make sure that happens. Now lastly, the churches in our community are partnering together with the Community Access Center to donate non-perishable food and canned goods to families who are in need. If you were not aware, the Community Access Center was started during the 100-year flood, I believe they call it here, in 2007. Over the years, the Community Access Center has provided food for people all over the area. Now, if you would like to donate food during this time, we're not going to give it directly to the Community Access Center, but you can drop any food items, again, non-perishable, off at the Chamber of Commerce, which is on Pennsylvania Avenue, just before you get to the railroad tracks. You can also drop it here at the church, and we'll make sure that it gets to the Chamber of Commerce to be delivered to families who are in need during this difficult time. Now, thank you for your time this morning. This has been your local news. I'm Pastor Todd.
And I'm Pastor Bill.
Good morning and good news. Now, I gotta go and disinfect.
Disclaimer. We understand and respect the need for social distancing. The intent for this video is to bring appropriate laughter to the situation. Also, these announcements were recorded prior to the governor's issued stay-at-home policy, so some announcements will be handled differently.
Well, there you go, folks. It's now time to worship. Let's get our hearts prepared for the word this morning and also for what God wants to say to us through the inspired words that God has given people across the years to help us as we sing to get in contact with Him. Worship team, Lord bless you this morning.
Only see.
did overcome. And that is our hope and our truth today. Let's continue singing now. This is King of My Heart.
Refuge and strength always.
your prayer today. Just close your eyes and speak to Him right now.
I lift my eyes up, my help comes from.
Thank you so much, worship team. Aaron, thank you again for listening to the Spirit. I'm sure for everybody, but certainly for me today, that worship package is something I just want to keep on my heart and want to give, I guess maybe we could call a quick shout out today to a couple of people who
can't be on the worship team right now, and Jeff and Lene and all your family, we just want you to know we love you as you're going through extra stuff during this time. We miss you being up here. We're thankful for the people who are here and who have been filling in, but we miss you guys. And just want you to know, again, God's already out there. He's already out ahead. And Jeff, as you now begin to prepare for your surgery and all the things that will be happening, just want you to know, guys, we love you. Well, today we want to continue on in Matthew chapter 6. We'll also be looking at a passage of Scripture in Philippians chapter 4. So if you want to have that ready, we'll be looking at that just briefly to kind of kick us off and get us into the topic of prayer and fasting. Last week we talked about giving, and again, we've got these three important things that become a part of our lives when we're Christians, when we live in the light of the cross of Christ. We live these three important, what I call, pillars of good works, and that is we become giving people, we become people who pray, we become people who fast, which literally, and we'll talk about it in just a minute, literally means that we sacrifice things in our lives that we might draw closer to God and do the things that He asks us to do. But as we start off this morning and think about prayer and fasting, on the screen, hopefully, is a little game that has come out over the last few years. It used to be used by the corporate world to try to test the creativity of people, job applicants. And it's nine little dots in a square. And the instruction for you this morning, I'm going to give you just 1 minute at the most. I want you to know that if you get a little frustrated and you can't figure it out, I looked at this thing for 10 minutes when I first did it, and I never figured it out. So most people can't figure it out, and we'll talk about that in just a couple of minutes. But if you have a piece of paper there, put the little nine dots, or maybe you want to do it in your head, and here's your instructions. You have four lines, and you got to put your pen on the paper, and you can draw four straight lines. Every time you turn and go a different direction, you have to that counts as the second line. You got four lines, and you can't take your pen off the paper, and you have to connect all the dots with just four lines. So see if you can do it in your head, or just real quickly wherever you're at home, try to connect those nine dots. Have to connect each and every one of them with four lines. Do, 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 do. All right, there we go. Couple more seconds here. All right, let's put up the solution. Again, that didn't give you very much time to try to figure it out. But the interesting thing is, and I didn't figure it out, and most people don't. Very few people think it through, even after being given a considerable amount of time. You kind of have to go up and out, but what you have to do is you got to go outside the box. And most of us, when we look at a puzzle or something, we think, wow, we've got to work inside the box. I know I'm doing a puzzle right now, a national park puzzle, and everything's inside the rim. Everything's inside the box. And we're used to looking at things and only seeing what's inside the little box that we're given. But if you're going to be effective and get this little puzzle work, you got to go outside the box. And when you can draw outside the box, you can connect all the lines. When we think about prayer and fasting, that's really what prayer and fasting is all about. It's about spiritually, in that part of us that can reach out to things that are greater than us. It's about learning to get in touch with God, who is outside the box. We really can't get outside the boxes of our lives. This is all we know, the things we experience, the things that go on in the world. But by prayer and by learning to sacrifice some things so that we might have greater things in the kingdom of God, we learn to get outside the little box, the little nine-dot box that we live in, and we find the greater things that God has for us in our lives. So today when we talk about prayer and fasting, it's going to help us understand that prayer and fasting is not so that we can get God to do the things
that we think he should be doing from our limited perspective. So often that's what prayer is to us if we're not careful. We just bring a laundry list to God. And I want to say again, as I did last week, God hears our laundry list. God hears us when we cry out to him. But the real purpose of prayer and fasting, again, it is not just to provide a laundry list for God, but for us to truly learn how to trust him, because he lives outside all of the boxes that define our earthly existence. So a couple of quick definitions this morning as we go down through here in Matthew chapter 6. First of all, what is prayer? Prayer is communicating with God. I want you to think about that for just a moment this morning, that we can communicate with God. God, who is the God of the universe, the one who is eternal. He always has been. He is now, and he always will be. He governs everything that goes out there in the universe. And this God decided that he wanted to create something, someone, us, humankind, so that he could really have a relationship with them. And the scripture says he made us in his image. And when you go all the way back to the beginning of Genesis, it's a beautiful story that God used to walk around with human beings. He walked around in the garden and had perfect, unhindered fellowship with his creation. If you've been around the church and you're familiar with the story, we messed that all up because we decided we wanted to do things our own way. And the story of the scripture of God's word is how through the Old Testament and the nation of Israel, but now also through the work of Jesus Christ, that he's got that relationship reestablished. And it's maybe not as perfect and as wonderful as it was in the beginning. One day it will be. But he gives us the opportunity to have a relationship with him. Well, prayer is our ability to communicate with God. Think about that. Because he created us and we're his masterpiece creation, he decided that he wanted to communicate directly with us. The God of the universe, each and every one of us, as insignificant as we may feel like we are, each and every one of us has the opportunity to talk to God, to listen to God. And for God to be able to get us out of this little nine-dot box that we so often live in and experience the eternal, the spiritual things of God. And when we do that, we have the opportunity to communicate with the hope of getting to know God better in Jesus Christ. That's amazing. We get to know God, and we get to know him better. And as we do that, then it becomes wonderful that we do something that the world doesn't like, and that is that we learn to submit. We learn to submit our life and the life of others to a God that is bigger than we are. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and verses 6 and 7 tell us this. I think I wrote 4 down there, but we're going to start with verse 6. It says this: do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the God of peace, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. See, so often when we're stuck in our little nine-dot boxes, we get overwhelmed, and it's a natural thing for us as human beings to become anxious, and we look all around, and we see all the things that are happening in our little nine-dot box, and we get overwhelmed by it, and anxiety comes to our lives. But prayer and sacrificing to have a deeper relationship with God gets us in touch with something that is greater. And so the scripture tells us here that prayer is about taking our anxiety and all the things we don't understand and laying those things before God. And here's the promise, that if we'll do that, the God of peace, which transcends all of it, which lives outside of all of it, that God of peace, which transcends all of our ability to understand, it will guard our hearts in Christ Jesus. And I don't know about you this morning, as we have been talking and singing about
about the greatness of God. God's brought peace to my heart again. But yet I know tomorrow when I get up, all of the things in my little nine-dot box will get bigger again. But through prayer and through the things that only God can do, we have the opportunity to have a relationship with God in prayer. Now what is fasting? Fasting, I think, sometimes is kind of misunderstood by a lot of people. Fasting is really just sacrificing something for God. It's saying no to something that our body and our mind says, I must have that. And we say no to it so that in a bigger and a more powerful way, we can say yes to God. What's an example of that? Most people think about food when we think about fasting. And fasting, one of the big ways that we can do that is to fast a meal. But you can also fast a television show. There's all kinds of things you can fast. But the idea is that as you're giving that up, you're saying no to that. You're hoping to say yes to God. If any of you have fasted for a period of time, I've done 72 and 96-hour fasts during revival times. It's interesting how fasting works, because the first several hours after you've fasted for 7, 8, 9, 10 hours, your belly starts going, oh, I'm dying. I'm not going to make it. Oh, I can't go another minute, and just all visions of donuts and every kind of a thing you can imagine just appear before you. But it's really interesting, about hour 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, all of that begins to go away. And you kind of settle in to a recognition that if you don't eat immediately, you're not going to die. And what the scripture encourages us, and certainly what I found, is that sometimes we need to get away from food and constantly eating it. And what has always happened to me is during these times, it's been a time of spiritual growth. It's been a time of kind of clearing out my head and my life and really being able to say yes to some of the things of God. Now, I have been on an imposed fast for the last couple of weeks. I can't watch sports. You know why I can't watch sports? Because there is no sports. I love sports, and if I'm not careful, I just come home every evening and go. Gail teases me that if they had a Tiddlywinks championship on ESPN, I'd watch that. I don't know why, it just kind of gets my mind in neutral. But you know what I've found? There's no sports, and I'm finding that I'm doing other things. I'm spending more time with God. I'm spending more time with Gail and the dogs and spending more time outside and doing things around the house. We went out to Elk City Lake the other day and just enjoyed how beautiful it was. And I'm just finding that as I kind of have an imposed fast on this particular part of my life, that I'm enjoying things that I used to do. I'm working a puzzle right now. So that's what fasting is. Fasting is when we take something and we say no to it, not because we're trying to deprive ourselves, but we say no to it so that we might say yes to God. And this is very important when we fast. Fasting is not about trying to get God again to do something, but it's about knowing the heart of God and recognizing again that as we fast and then as we pray, God is much bigger than the nine-dot box that we live in. So let's look to the Word this morning. Let's look back in Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6 tells us this, and we're going to kind of skip around just a little bit this morning because I'm going to go through these two sections that talk about prayer and then also that talk about fasting. So verse 5 tells us this, and when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. Now I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. Down on verse 16, it says this, and when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show other people that they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. Jesus says the same thing he says about giving, that when you're giving for recognition or when you're giving to get something, inevitably, whatever you get out of it, then you've received your reward in full. He uses the word hypocrites there again. Hypocrite, if you'll remember, if you were here last week, if you listened to the message, it means an actor. People who are just going through the motions, who are just acting things out. And Jesus is directing this to us, but he's directing it to people in that day and time who felt like if they would just demonstrate their piety before God and before other people, that somehow then, just because they were demonstrating their piety, that God was going to act in their lives. Each and every day they would start the day by reciting the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6. And then they would have prayers that they would do all day. And what I want you to know here is that doing those things is a good thing. If you have never read the Shema in Deuteronomy chapter 6, I encourage you to do this with your family, with your kids, whoever's around there. It's a powerful thing to read, and I haven't done it before, but I would think a powerful way to start each and every day. And so reciting the Shema and reciting these beautiful prayers was not the problem. The problem was that it had just become something that they were doing each and every day, hoping that they could just curry the favor of God. I thought back to when I was a little kid, and I had a little memorized prayer I did every night. My mom would read me a Bible story, and I would kneel down beside the bed, and I would go, "Now bless Mommy, and bless Daddy, and bless my sister Taryn, and bless Popo and Grandmother, Granddaddy and Grandma, Aunt Carolyn and Uncle Jess, and little baby Wally." Boom, man, I was back in bed. Nothing wrong with that prayer, especially when you're a little kid. You're just learning how to pray. But, you know, if my prayers had not become any deeper or any more heartfelt than just that little prayer, then what begins to happen is prayer and fasting and sacrificing for God simply becomes a way to invoke God to do the things that are in our little nine-dot box. So what does he tell us to do? Look there in verse 6. He says, this is how we should do it. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. As you do that, then your Father who sees what is done in secret, he will reward you. Down here in beginning in verse 17, and we'll go on to verse 18 also. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret, he will reward you. Just like giving, communicating with God, sacrificing for God is the same way. We pray and we fast so that we can have a heart for God. Sometimes we do pray about specific things and we pray for other people, but the most important thing that we always want to do is we want to know the heart of God. We want to want and desire what he wants for our lives. We want, and this is always the hard one for me, we want to desire what he wants for other people also, for the people we love. You know, sometimes I'm willing to accept anything about my life. But when it comes to my wife, when it comes to my daughter, when it comes to the people that I just so deeply love in my life, I want to tell God what to do. But prayer and sacrificing is really about learning that we can trust God, learning that he never goes to sleep, that he is always there in our lives. And if we will let him, he can get us out of our nine-dot box that we always tend to live in. Now, listen to what he says there in verses 7 and 8. He says this, and when you pray, do not keep on babbling like the pagans. And anytime you see the word pagans and Jesus is talking about it, he's talking about the Romans. Don't keep on babbling like the pagan Romans, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. And hear this, people of God. Your Father knows what you need. He hears you running down the hallway. He knows what's going on in your life. He knows what you need. And he knows it before you even ask him. These pagan Romans, like our world today, they had a god for everything. a God for this and a God for that. And let's not judge them too harshly, because folks, our world has their own gods. We have gods of pleasure, gods of food, gods of just about everything we can imagine that we somehow put our trust in, thinking that they're going to bring the things in life that we desire so much. And they thought that the more they prayed to those gods, the quantity would increase the odds that the gods would be nice to them. And that's what our world does. The more we can participate in this or that, somehow the more we're going to be happy. But we need to realize that we don't need to pray selfishly, because God already knows what we need. And so today, in closing, I just want to read to you and just a few words of explanation about the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Isn't it amazing? Jesus doesn't just deal in platitudes and things for us to think about, but after he tells us and gives us all this instruction about prayer and sacrificing, he actually helps us to know how to pray. And it's important that when we look at the Lord's Prayer, it is a beautiful and a wonderful thing to just pray the Lord's Prayer sometimes. But what the Lord's Prayer really is it's kind of like an outline. It's kind of like a big picture thing. So that every time we pray, and every time we do something in our lives, give something up, that we might draw closer to God. That as we're drawing closer to him, and as we're praying, and as we're talking to him, that we would know what it is that pleases God when we pray to him. And so Jesus says, this is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Every time you pray, oh dear people of God, honor God. Tell him how much you love him. Tell him that you understand who he is, and honor everything about him. These worship songs that we sang today, a big part of them were just our opportunity to tell God we recognize these things about you. We honor you. We hallow your name. Jesus says then, just say your kingdom come, your will be done on this earth right here as it is in heaven. That just means seek his will. It's so easy to seek our will and sometimes to pray for our own will. But the scripture says, as we honor God and as we submit to God, it is so important that we would seek his will first. Because sometimes the will of God takes some really strange turns. But as we trust him, as we serve him, and as we love him each and every day that we live our lives and we seek his will, he leads us and gets us where we need to go. When it comes to our provision, when it comes to the food that we need to eat, the shelter that we need in our lives, he just says, tell God, give me what I need today. I don't know about you, I'm a planner. And there's nothing wrong with planning and thinking about the future. But it's important to remember to trust God for today. Give me this day my daily bread. He says also that we need to value our relationships, our relationship with him, our relationships with the people around us, that we should always remember to not let anything get in the way of our relationship with God. God, forgive me for any trespass in my life. As I remember to forgive others so that I don't trespass against them. He just reminds us again there in verses 14 and 15 that if we forgive others, he can forgive us. But if we don't, it's hard for him to forgive us, because this thing is a package deal. And then the last thing he says is, don't lead us into temptation, but deliver us from all of the evil that's in the world. Desire the righteousness of God. This is the prayer that Jesus taught us how to pray. And the desire of our hearts needs to be to not live in the little 9-dot box that we find ourselves in, but to see where God is working and allow us spiritually and in every way to live eternally, to live the eternal things of God. I want to remind you today that the election that's coming up and all of the things that are happening in your life regarding your finances and relationships and all of the things that we have to worry about today, and particularly COVID-19, all of those things are in a 9-dot box. Those things are not eternal. They don't exist outside of anything other than this fallen 9-dot box world that we live in. let God get you outside that box and remind you each and every day about how big He is. I was reminded of Humpty Dumpty as I was thinking about this nine-dot box in my own life. You remember what Humpty Dumpty says? Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. And all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. Well, God has kind of reminded us again. The things that have happened in the world have knocked humanity off the wall again, and we have fallen off the wall, and we're all just kind of laying on the ground now, kind of cracked and broken in some ways. Let's remember that as this world continues to be cracked and broken, all the king's horses and all the king's men are not going to put our world back together again. All the politicians in this world, all of the doctors, and as important as these people are, oh, I thank God for them every day. But all of those people are not going to put the world back together again. There's only one who is going to put the world back together again. And that is Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And so trust in Him. Keep your relationship strong and vital through prayer and through sacrificing whatever it is you need to sacrifice in your life for Him. I'm going to ask our worship team if they'll come up and if they will lead us in a closing song. But what I would like for us to do, if you would with me, is for us together to let's just pray the Lord's Prayer as we conclude our time of listening to the Word of God. Pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you, and let's sing now and proclaim again the power, the goodness of God.
Your word will